I can't address that because I just don't know. Do you know about how the derivative works?
In any copyright, the way to show, you know, infringement is that show two things. You know, if you're the artist, you're claiming that somebody else infringed. You have to show that they had access to your work, and that can, you know, that's obviously shown through testimony. You can take, you know, oh, I was at this gallery. You have to show that somebody was at this gallery or had access to your work, or was at your website or whatever. The second thing, which is what, you know, we're saying, is kind of the gray area, the water area, is the substantial similarity. And then obviously there's no definition for that. That's just a case by case kind of thing, right? So, like,
but isn't filing the copyright constructive notice that they have seen it?
Right, that's like what they call like prima facie, and that's like it raises the presumption that that's yours, and that, you know. So that's why registration is so important. But those are the two things you have to show when you find your claim of copyright.
Yeah.
So if you think you're infringing the derivative work and parody, there are exceptions to copyright infringement. There are, you know, if you're parodying something, satire.
Like on a Saturday Night Live, get away with everything. Well, it's like,
yeah, you can take a pair of nylon shoes and put them on a pedestal because you're making some kind of, you know, pronouncement or some kind of philosophical statement about Nike and like their world domination. Like, it won't be infringement. It's parody, a satire about Nike. But if you're just trying to claim that like you designed those pair of shoes, then that's an infringement. So clearly, you know, you sort of have to take that.
How about a camel suit?
Yeah, exactly. That's a Warhol piece, of course. But again, that's a satirical piece in and of itself too, because that's how Warhol maybe could have gotten away with that. But it's a very fine line, and nowadays with digital media and video art, it's all much more accessible and much easier. Lines get grayer and grayer, but if you believe you're infringing, a lot of times you can also get permission to use works more than you think you can. Sometimes if you really want to use something, you can contact that artist, you can contact whoever owns that thing, and you can say, you know, I'd really like to borrow this for this kind of thing, and you get it. And if you have permission, then you're also safe. So, you know.
Okay, we have a question.
So if you are going to do a marketing proposal, before you present your presentation, what's the best way to protect you before going into that meeting?
You can copyright. Okay, the letter from the client with our office. I happen to take it off, but the letter was copyrighted. Of course, he's having a trademark letter too, so I guess he's copyrighted.
Everything.
You know, every time he gets up and says something.
But you're starting with an idea, a concept that you want to present to the company for them to use. Well, they can make a slight alteration of your idea and claim it as their own. So it's right up
above. That's why it's very difficult. And by the way, I know the lawyers.
Right, but I mean, I'm just saying, if there was a marketing proposal, what's the best way to protect
a lot of contract.
Oh, you mean that's between you and the person
that you want to make a presentation
I mean,
to them?
Look, you can start with a non-disclosure. A non-disclosure, which, you know, there's dozens of them floating around. And, you know, again, the non-disclosure is, people can get around it. But you can start with a non-disclosure. And then once you get to the point where you're actually doing something with this person in the agreement, you have in there that the works, you know, maybe that the work belongs to whoever's paying you for it too. Those are negotiate. What happens if you stop in the middle? I mean, I just ended up doing one with an ad agency. I was representing the ad agency, and it was, I think we had three work belonging to my client because he was paying. But a lot of times you'll see it belongs to the creator. Also, just depends what you're able to get away with. I've seen agreements come to me, some other lawyers there that have copyright, whether they actually filed or not. Yeah.
Can you talk about
the copyright is everything that we were talking about. Now, the trademark is if we wanted to trademark Locus Project, we can trademark that name. It's a lot more involved. You know, it can get somewhat expensive. It can get challenged when you file with the PTO or have the trademark office. Because what happens is, and I've seen this happen with names. You know, if we decided to trademark the name Locus Project, you know, somebody in Seattle may have a restaurant that they filed called Locus Project. And they may challenge it, and then a decision has to be made whether you want to change the name. I've seen all kinds of things come from this, but.
You can patent the concept
that they're getting away from that. Now, there's a lot of computer programs and ways of doing things that they're patenting that I think are starting to get away from that. Companies that's been getting pretty confusing, but not so much trademark. Most of the trademark has to do with the likeness and has to do with the name, but not so much of the process.
The name has to be attached to a good.
Right.
If you go, they actually have a really good website also that the United States Patent and Trademark Office, USPTO.org, and there, basically, you're going to trademark like wine belts or a magazine name, or it is a name, but it should be attached to, they have a list of all kinds of goods that would be attached to. And you can do a search on the name if you want to trademark. If you're a fashion designer, a jewelry designer, or whatever you want, you should trademark your name.
What ends up happening is, you know, again, you're the recipient of the letter, and it's a cease and desist letter, and then you have to decide what you want to do. You know, a lot of times you just go, I had a client who changed the name of his business and said, I'm going to call it XYZ. You know, he had his business here, and he changed it from whatever it was. You know, he was in France, and he had the business here. I'm going to call it XYZ. And I said, fine. In Florida, I said, it's fine, but you look at every place where you do business and see if somebody comes with a name. So he said, oh, of course, I did that. Everything's okay. He did it. I said, okay, I'm telling you, you really should check. I need to go to my associate lawyer who does these things. Now he didn't want to do it. Well, he's there now, and he's probably spending twice as much. He went out and changed everything. He changed his website. And he tells me that, oh, then we got the letter. And the letter was cease and desist and everything. So I went on the website, I looked at their website, and see, almost the identical name. And they've been in business for 30 years under that name. And I said, didn't you see this?
So easy to search.
And come on. So he has to change his name. And he has to go through all kinds of things. I mean, besides the expensive stationery and the website and the designer and everything else, there's all kinds of besides hiring,
they call it considerable confusion. So
it's
if you go to a local project, there's like some zoological research company in California, that's not going to be a problem.
Right, exactly.
It's just an art.
Confusion. But surprisingly, for any of you, just one aside, if you ever do want to register something, well, I do them a lot, and I get confused a lot with the trademarks. And surprisingly enough, with the copyright office and trademark, their helpline is like amazingly helpful. Like you can call them if you're confused and say, you know, this count, does this matter? Should I register under more than one category? Because trademarks are expensive, they're about $375 a piece. And so if you're registering in more than one category, you're paying $375 for your category, it's very expensive. So call, you know,
believe it or not, just the PTO, not just the patent trademark office, but all these government offices, you'd be surprised. You're nice to them. Sometimes they really go nice to you. Sometimes. I've had good experiences, and I've had bad experiences too.
Like consumer reports that tell you to stay away from certain things. Like, is there a book out there that says stay away from this from there?
You mean like for people stay away from Yeah, but you don't need a consumer's report for that. Just ask people in the store. And you're probably going to hear every story that ever existed for what, you know, bad galleries besides this one.
Well, there's still businesses that look surprised to me. They still find.